Hello, and thank you for joining us in this celebration of the new publication, Coronavirus Haiku. I think I could say that by now. A collection from the writers of the Worker Writers School, just published by Kenning Editions. I'm Tanya Hollis, Interim Director of the Labor Archives and Research Center at San Francisco State University, which is located on the occupied territories of the Ramaytush Ohlone and the coastal Miwok. The Labor Archives is pleased and honored to be a co-sponsor of this event with the Poetry Center, as the Worker Writers School supports writers from one of New York City's most ubiquitous yet least heard populations, low-wage workers, following in a long tradition of similar schools such as the California Labor School, which was started here in San Francisco in the 1940s, and later the San Francisco Waterfront Writers and Artists Association in the 70s, both represented in the Labor Archives. These schools create spaces and time for workers to learn and practice their writing in community outside of their workplaces while also building solidarity. I'd now like to introduce Mark Nowak, who is also a founding director of the school. He's a poet, cultural critic, playwright, and essayist from Buffalo, New York, and the author of three poetry collections, Coal Mountain Elementary in 2009, Shut Up, Shut Down in 2004, and Revenants in 2000, all from Coffee House Press. A portion of his new critical book, Social Poetics, also from Coffee House Press, was published in 2020 and chronicles his work with the Worker Writers School. A quick note for all of you in the audience, any questions you have for the writers, please put them in the Q&A rather than the chat, and I'll share them at the end if there is time. Mark Nowak, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. We are super happy to be here today. When we started discussing the date of an event to celebrate the Coronavirus Haiku after Labor Day, our brand new book from Kenning, we came up with this day, September 30th, because it's a very important day in terms of worker poetry. It's the anniversary of the death of Chinese worker poet Xu Liji. And I just want to read a brief passage or two from Social Poetics, in which I talk about his work to try to center us for this evening's program. He was a worker at Foxconn, the multinational corporation, huge, massive factory in China. Foxconn tried to argue that the record number of suicides of its workers was unrelated to its management style, working conditions, or wage policies, or to its practice of crushing the dreams of its young workers. Instead, after blaming all the suicides on personal problems and mental health issues, the company encouraged employees to visit the employee care center and hit punching bags with pictures of their supervisors to vent their anger and frustration in newly opened stress release rooms. They also brought in monks to try to release the souls of the suicide victims. After the monks departed, the number of suicides increased. In the company's most vulgar gesture, Foxconn began to install 3 million square meters of safety nets between dormitory buildings to prevent employees from killing themselves by jumping off the rooftop. Foxconn CEO Terry Gu, known more to many as the king of outsourcing, dubbed the nets, quote, nets with a loving heart. Foxconn's best efforts to reduce the rate of worker suicides failed. Xu Liji was just one of the workers who somehow avoided these nets with a loving heart when he leaped to his death on September 30th, 2014. He too was a poet. Prior to his suicide, he wrote stanzas and poems with lines like these from his poem, I Fall Asleep Just Standing Like That, which illustrates the effects of contemporary capitalism on today's working class. And here's from his poem. Full of working words, workshop, assembly line, machine, work card, overtime, wages. They've trained us, they've trained me to be docile, don't know how to shout or rebel. And so I wanted to use those words to kind of focus us today in our listening to the poets from the Worker Writers School. Barker Writers School has been in collaboration with PEN America for 11 years now. We offer free monthly workshops in collaboration with worker centers. And today you'll hear from workers who are part of organizations such as Domestic Workers United, the New York Taxi Workers Alliance, the Street Vendor Project, and others. For the entire time of the coronavirus haiku, the first year of it, we would meet once and sometimes twice a month online, working on creative writing workshops. And the poems you hear, the haiku you'll hear, are a result of those workshops. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first two readers tonight. You'll hear first Lorraine Garnett, a nanny from Brooklyn, and then Davidson Garrett, a recently retired yellow cab driver from Manhattan. Lorraine?
Hi, everyone. I am Lorraine Garnett. I'm a nanny, and I've been a member of the Workers' Writers School for approximately 4 years. And it's just one of the greatest decisions I've made to be a part of the group. We are like family, and Mark is our leader. And, you know, earlier on, there were like 10 mics, and I think that's someone above talking to us that we need more of Mark. So thank you again. Want to also thank San Francisco State University, Steve and Tanya for hosting. Thank you for having us. So Mark says, if we talk less, we can get to read more haikus. So that's it. Thank you. I'm going to start with this one. It's not in the book, but it happened today. I take the train. I commute on to work every day on the train. And as you know, the haiku is it's very spontaneous. I think it's, you know, very tangible with all the five senses. And on the train, it's just a haiku heaven. Okay, here I go. Blowing nose in mask. That is nasty stink shit on friggin' 5 train. Okay, and now I start with the book. Missed first day of spring. Positive or negative, cherry blossom looms. Missed first day of spring. Positive or negative, cherry blossom looms. Lashed to the forehead. Open processing meat plant. Start cotton picking. Lashed to the forehead. Open processing meat plant. Start cotton picking. Hi, everyone. Jail with corona. $1,000 bail money. Paper towel wipe. Jail with corona. $1,000 bail money, paper towel wipe. Yes. Just need sun moment. Swept up breadcrumbs, concrete floor, shared cornmeal fish fry. You know, we were also stuck at home during that time. And this is during the early stage of the pandemic when, you know, we didn't know what was going on. The government didn't know what was going on, what really scientific to tell us. So it was really very trying time. We were all just so petrified. And to be honest with you, I was afraid of dying. It was really, really scary. Saved by the haiku. Afraid, museum bedroom. What if bones are found? Saved by the haiku. Afraid, museum bedroom. What if bones are found? Hospital room shrines. Doctors, nurses, wearing white. Final words, FaceTime. Black blood on white sheet. Bird season, black birds only. mother hen grief tweets. Careers changing, respiratory therapist same, nurses undertaker. Murder on asphalt, Minnesota crushed cockroach, blood morph word, mama. Murder on asphalt, Minnesota crushed cockroach, blood morph word, mama. Young black man jogging, two white men hunting, blood sports, spring a trap, three shots. Terrorizing streets, white bodies on black bodies, bloody, bloody moon. Terrorizing street, white bodies on black bodies, bloody, bloody moon. Listening to dogs bark, sirens howling, fireflies, the dog walker died. Listening to dogs bark, sirens howling, fireflies, the dog walker died. Sweet banana bread, chokehold, knee, rope, bullets, lies. Where is the sugar? Sweet banana bread, chokehold, knee, rope, bullets, lies. Where is the sugar? And I'll do this last one. No vaccine, no fuck. Go ahead, do your research. No heads, Google it. No vaccine, no fuck. Go ahead, do your research. No heads, Google it. Thank you, everyone.
Hello? It looks like I'm on. Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. And thanks so much to San Francisco State University for honoring us by having us here tonight. Thanks to Mark Nowak, our wonderful director of the Penn Worker Writers School. My name is Davidson Garrett. And I've been a member of the Worker Writers School since 2013, when Mark conducted a taxi driver workshop. I drove a taxi from 1978, a yellow taxi from 1978 until 2018. I had to retire for two reasons. My eyes gave out after 40 years, and Uber destroyed my business. I'd like to share with you some of the haiku from our book, Coronavirus Haiku. Empty taxi cabs cruising along avenues with bankrupt drivers. No opera now. The virus darkened the Met, but birds sing to me. Time for coffee break. Cabbie double parks by store. A cop tickets him. I lounge in night clothes in the middle of the day, quarantine fashion. Gulf Coast hurricanes, warnings from Dr. Fauci, President Trump golfs. White supremacist hate to don mask for safety, prefer Klan hoodies. And my last one I'll share with you is a new one. We aligned with a group in London last year, a similar group to the Worker Writers School, and they published a little anthology in the summer, and they chose this one. Empire State Building, shrouded in thick fog at dawn, hiding from King Kong. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Davidson, and thank you, Lorraine. Those were just fantastic. Thank you, Davidson. Thank you, Lorraine. Those were fantastic.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
The next two readers we have today are Keely and Seth. Keely spent the beginning part of the pandemic working in a booth underground in the subways in New York City. She's also a board member of the Street Vendor Project. And Seth is, like Davidson, a longtime New York City taxi driver and a New York Mets fan. Keely?
Good evening, everyone. Good afternoon as well. My name is Keely Nkariane. I am a street vendor and now a retired transit worker. I just want to thank Steve and Tanya and your team for allowing us to be part of this wonderful, wonderful group. And I would like to also thank Mark and our school for allowing us to have this opportunity to learn about haikus. And I am going to read my haiku that was selected to be part of the book. The first one, no cash in the book, no service from 1 to 5 a.m. Full moon light locally. No cash in the book. No service from 1 to 5 a.m. Full moon light locally. The second one. It is not easy. COVID-19 in the subway. Isolation and trauma. It is not easy. COVID-19 in the subway, isolation and trauma. The third one, 23% Blacks in the workforce need to sue for advancement, enjoying false yellows, ambers, and orange. 23% Blacks in the workplace need to sue for advancement, enjoying false yellow, amber, and orange. The second one, use vending machines. No passengers in the subway. Full moonlight yesterday. Use the vending machines. No passengers in the subway. Full moonlight yesterday. The next one, anger provoked at work. Gender-based violence. Men need to stop. Anger provoked at work. Gender-based violence. Men need to stop. The next one. Stress riding the subway. Questions without the answers. Not workers' fault. Stress riding the subway. Questions without answers. Not workers' fault. The next one. 270 is your magic. You made the rules. Time for pumpkin pie. 270 is your magic. You made the rules. Time for pumpkin pie. This is the last one. November 7, 2020 brought peace. New chapter, new president. Time to clean leaf piles. November 7, 2020 brought peace. New chapter, new president. Time to clean the leaf piles. Thank you all for listening. Have a good evening.
Hello. Hi, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Hi, I'm Seth Goldman. I've been a yellow taxi driver since 1984, and I've been part of the worker riders group since 2013, as my pal Davis and Garrett has. And I want to thank San Francisco State University and Mark Nowak. And it's a great privilege to read. So I'm going to read a few haikus. First, I will wet the instrument. That's how cabbies travel now. We travel around the world. I'm in Barbados right now. So here we go. Strong April flowers. Strong April showers will bring cabbies dead flowers. Workers, not Wall Street. So isolating. Cabbing down Broadway today. The wind screams, Mary. 9 hours empty. A 12-hour taxi shift. Spent six with Basie. Made $4 an hour. Spent 60 on groceries. Will eat till I'm sick. My wife makes our bed. Feels so warm and smells so good. Leave at 4 a.m.? Ubers have returned. Barely earn minimum wage. A sweatshop on wheels. Turmeric water fuels cabbie's marathon shift. Is this all there is? I got me a wife, 10-year-old bottle of scotch. Which do I need more? Five a.m. N train. Subway showers overnight. My fart just hangs there. Helicopter hovers, deafening on dark Broadway, Greenwich Village tears. Reconciliation, lunch with Trump voting cousin, blow the damn bridge up. And last but not least, not in the book, we get ticketed a lot as cabbies because, you know, we're driving 70, 80 hours a week. And when we get pulled over, you know, we come back to the garage, we call getting ticketed, coppered. East 7th Street blues. Everybody must get stoned. Cabbie gets coppered. Thank you.
Thank you, Seth, and thank you, Keely. Incredible stuff. I love the new one, Seth. If people in the audience are wondering about people reading their haiku twice, it's a technique that we learned from the great Japanese translator of haiku, Hiroaki Sato. He has a book that came out a couple of years ago on New Directions called On Haiku, and it's translated dozens and dozens and dozens of books. And we brought him in to host a workshop, and it was a technique that he taught us that he uses all the time in readings and events to help us hear it a little better. Sometimes the haiku passes so quickly, and reading it a second time, he felt really allowed us to hear it more deeply. And we have two more poets yet today. First will be Alando reading. He is currently a public school teacher. He came to us some number of years ago when he was working at the Golden Crust and has stayed with us. We're happy he's with us. And finally, Christine Lewis, who is the secretary cultural organizer for Domestic Workers United, which passed the first Bill of Rights for domestic workers in any state, anywhere in the United States. So, Alando and Christine.
Good evening, everyone. I'm super happy to be here tonight. It's still a little disorienting because I feel like I'm just talking to a computer. But I'm super happy to be here. As Mark said, my name is Orlando McIntyre. I've been with the Worker Writer School since 2015 when I was invited by the incomparable Miss Christine Lewis. And it has been quite a journey. I started with the group as a cashier at a Golden Cross Bakery, which is a Jamaican restaurant. And, you know, kept on attending the workshops over the course of the years while I try to finish my undergrad studies. And now I'm, you know, like I completed it and I am currently a public school teacher in New York. It's been quite a challenge, especially during the height of the pandemic. It meant that literally our worlds as teachers got flipped upside down, just like everybody else's lives. We went from seeing scholars and students in person to literally talking to them through the computer for over a year and change. However, we found a way to adjust and we are alive. So I'm super grateful to be here. Thank you to San Francisco State University, Tanya and Steve and the rest of the team. Definitely humbled. I'm still pinching myself. Like, am I really here? And to Pen America and Mark Nowak, you have been an instrumental figure in, I guess, this journey I am as developing as a poet. I must say, when you introduced me to the haiku, I was a little bit hesitant because I'm just like, I have a lot of words to say. Don't know if I could break it down into just a few lines and a few syllables. However, with your tutelage, here we are with a book. And for those in the audience, if you have not gotten the opportunity to purchase the book, please go and get yourself a copy. I am hoping and dreaming that we will make the New York Times bestseller list. I'm still holding on to that dream because what we have to dream. We have to dream. And in the words of Christine again, if she said, if you don't fight, you can't win. So I'm gonna try something a little bit different tonight. I've never done it before, but I am going to use one of the haikus that I penned in the book as a refrain. So you're gonna be hearing me repeat it throughout the course as I mix it with a few other selections. So here we go. Alternative life, gloves, body bags, face masks, crown, corona, king. Let's talk about freedom while celery juice digests and ginger tea cools. Lies and truths converge as unburied bodies roam Corona City. So let's talk about freedom while celery juice digests and ginger tea cools. Sure, everybody under house arrest because of COVID. So let's talk about freedom while celery juice digests and ginger tea cools. The rapture began, not how we expected. Saints sent home by COVID. Let's talk about freedom while celery juice digests and ginger tea cools. Feds stole our minds while we tripped on hope and fear. Still no stars in noon sky. So let's talk about freedom while celery juice digests and ginger tea cools. Home life and work life blend kinda rough like my green juice. Drink, but don't taste. So let's talk about freedom while celery juice digests and ginger tea cools. And more in COVID war, I sip absolute lawlessness, love with gloves and mask. Let's talk about freedom while celery juice digests and ginger tea cools. Decluttering truth reveals plantation living, existing, and mask. So let's talk about freedom while celery juice digests and ginger tea cools. Thank you for your time.
Oh, hi all. I'm a little vague in this picture right now. Thanks for all involved in putting this program together and including the Work Writers School. My name is Christine Yvette Lewis, and I've been with the Work Writers School since Mark came with that kernel, that first little kernel of working with workers in New York City and I guess around the globe. He posited his course to DWU, Domestic Workers United, and we fell on board. And we have been with the movement going on close to 11 years right now. And I like to say in the words of Dr. Barber from the Poor People's Campaign, this program is not a moment, it's a movement. And that said, I'll begin to read some of my haikus. And this one I'm gonna read is, I'm just recovering from COVID-19 and close to death's door. And while I was in the hospital in May, I spent 1 month from May 10th to June 12th. This poem was born because I'm looking at the nurses who were giving care. And it goes something like this. She cleans the crack of my ass as only a sister could. No sorrow down there. Again. She clean the crack of my ass as only a sister could, no sorrow down there. Considering that these women are going from jobs to jobs in these health facilities, and I'm laying on the hospital bed, just looking at the ceiling and looking at all that love that's given and afforded me, because, you know, we're in this pandemic, and they really enjoy doing what they did, but on thriving on so little. Let me read some of the haikus that's in the book, The Coronavirus Haiku. Mellow mist of fall, brush warm cheeks, rats scurry past brittle bins, a polite cat posture to pounce. Mellow mist of fall, brush warm cheeks, rats scurry past brittle bins, a polite cat posture to pounce. November wind loot, listless leaves, boughs of ash, birch, a dog in heat pant. November wind loot, listless leaves, boughs of ash, birch, a dog in heat pant. Brown women, warm, cold, bench, intersection of dreams, a train below groan. Brown women, warm, cold, bench, intersection of dreams, a train below groan. Above frigid railroad, North Station Plaza, 7 a.m., housekeepers, Lady of Guadalupe amulet, rope around index finger, balance madam's home, dust cloth, less than 50 now, American bread, hawk knitted caps, Mary Kay, DKNY, etched in hoodies, Daisy Dukes, pigeons in formation, shit on broken leaves. Above frigid railroad, North Station Plaza, 7 a.m., housekeepers, Lady of Guadalupe, amulet, rope around index finger, balance madam's home, dust cloth, less than 15 now, American bread, hawk knitted caps, Mary Kay, DKNY, etched in hoodies, Daisy Dukes, pigeons in formation, shit on broken leaves. And I'll do a couple more and then I'll be over. Rats, human vie for space on urban sidewalk, cracks in tenement walls. Rats, human vie for space on urban sidewalk, cracks in tenement walls.
I found a few locations for Ross near you.
Sorry. One of my favorite poems, one of my favorite haiku is Broken Woman Beg, Change. Sanitary napkin, a first, Wall Street next. Broken woman beg, change, sanitary napkin, a first, Wall Street next. Yep. And in the heights of COVID, this came to me in the heights of COVID. Contrary days, stressed fingers, pen sad notes, logged six, slippery treadmill. Contrary days, stressed fingers, pen sad notes, logged six, slippery treadmills. And I'll end on, let me get one more, and I'll say thank you and good night. Dismal season. Did I read this one before? Dismal season. Then I am reminded seeds sprout from cracks in concrete. Dismal season. Then I am reminded seeds sprout from cracks in concrete. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm just going to come back in and say that there are no questions, but if you have some, you can put them in the Q&A window for our readers and writers. And I'd also welcome anyone just from the readers to say anything they'd like to add.
Christina,
let me just say,
Christina, oh, go ahead.
Sorry, Mark. What I would like to add is that we're a community of workers, worker writers, whose struggle is the same. There's a thread that goes through this. And our stories are really poignant. Our stories are from a place where you want to tell, you, especially for nannies and caregivers and elder caregivers, and the immigrant story, where we're still fighting for basic living wage, where you want to give your employers the middle finger. You really can't. But hear what? Your pen is your friend, and you can write your truth to power. And so I feel really enamored having the work writers from different diaspora, different countries, different locations. Yet we could sit around that table every Saturday or on Zoom, as it is, you know, a new way of life that we've come to know, but share in that bread. I call that bread, the word. The word is with us, and the word is profound. The word is liberation. The word is speaking that truth and creating our truth, because it's our truth. You know what? We still mightn't get $15 now, but you know what? As an advocate, we could advocate, and we could come together, because community matters. And I thank Mark immensely for what he has been doing for the last past 10 years, not just in New York, but globally so. Thank you, Mark. And thank you for San Francisco State University for having us. Thank you. And thank you for work writers. Thank you. Yeah, together we're stronger and we're fierce and fabulous. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine. That's brilliant and so true. And I have to say that's some of the strongest language I've heard about the power of writing together in community. And I'd love to hear more about that, if anyone else is willing to speak to that and speak to what Christine has raised, because I think that's actually the meat of what is so brilliant about Coronavirus Haiku. Doing things in community, in solidarity.
I could just say a little bit about the haiku itself. I thought one of the luxuries of, unfortunately, the pandemic, there are not too many luxuries, but we were able to spend really a year, really almost a year and a half, sort of investigating haikus and reading about the history of haikus and seeing how they apply to our own life. I think that was what really made them congeal for me, that we were able to read what had been written in the past, and we were able to really put them in our own contemporary lives and make them real to us, so that our voice was being heard and we weren't imitating any other writer per se, because I don't know any other writer except my friend Seth had been driving a yellow cab that long that's writing haikus. So that was the nice thing for me, was that I was able to find my own voice in the haiku that I might not have, because a lot of traditional poetry workshops might spend a week or two on a haiku and move on to some other form. And we really did saturate ourselves with this beautiful form. And that was really a blessing for all of us. Thank you.
I have one question in the Q&A. Can the participants tell the story of how they found their way to the Worker Writer School? And I'll open that to anyone who wants to answer.
Yes. I think Davidson invited me. And, you know, I stumbled in with John McDonough, another cab driver and playwright. And, you know, it was, we clicked, I guess. It was a lot of fun. I was in my early 50s then. And, you know, for me, it was time to, like I've said, you know, to my friends, that in my early 50s, it was like 25 years had passed really quickly, and I wanted to slow down time. So I wanted to do things a little differently, learn new things. And this was perfect for me, you know, to start writing. I've always liked poetry very much. And so it, you know, it was a great thing. And Mark, of course, is very encouraging. And, you know, I've been doing it ever since. And I have to say about, you know, the last year and a half with the pandemic, you know, it's been an incredible time, actually, in New York City. And I imagine in San Francisco as well, because, you know, we care about our communities here. And, you know, I live in Greenwich Village. You know, we've probably 90% of us have been vaccinated at least. We're all concerned about our neighbors. It's not just about, you know, me, I, mine. It's about the community being safe and healthy. And I don't know if it's being near the ocean. Maybe that's makes a difference, but it seems people near the ocean are a little bit more concerned about their communities. Anyway, the you know, the writing has been in concert with all of this, with the pandemic, our community, and it's been great. You know, and I really am I just thrilled to speak to you and, you know, to be here with all my friends. And we'll carry on. The struggle continues because it's the struggle we live for.
Yeah, I could jump in here as well. One day, a Saturday, I'll never forget, Christine had walked into the Golden Cross. I get some food, and she walked in with a sign. She was at a protest after Eric Garner was murdered. And we got into like a very spirited conversation about whether or not protesting was effective. Christine was like, protesting makes sense. And like her mantra is, if you don't fight, you can't win. I, on the other side, was like, protesting almost at this point feels like a waste of time because we've been protesting from since forever. In Jamaica, they would say from before Wapi killed Philip. That means a long time and nothing seems to change. And we started talking and it was a very riveting conversation. And it just so happened that I wasn't supposed to be working that day. And just like, as the universe would have it, she would walk in with a placard and we started talking about France Fanon. And like the conversation went on. However, by the end of the conversation, we exchanged contact information. And a few weeks later, I was sitting in the park and I received a call. And it was Christine. Christine was like, Alando, I want you to come join this poetry workshop. And I was like, Christine, we had a very good conversation, but I am not a poet. So that is, it doesn't make sense. She was like, Alando, you should come. And, you know, I was just like, you know what, this is a woman of wisdom. So she said, come to this workshop. Why not? It's not taking anything off of me. A few dollars, yes, because it meant I would have to go to work late and lose an hour. And as an hourly worker, it meant if you're not in, you're losing an hour's pay. But I did nevertheless. And I went, and to Christine's point, it has definitely been a community. And a very eye-opening moment for me was when Alfreda Small, she's also one of the contributors to the book, we were having a conversation and Alfreda said, she told us her age, can't remember the age, but she was like, given the age that I am, sitting in this room, I feel like life is starting anew because I'm able to write. And that really grounded the entire experience for me. So since then, you know, like I have taken up writing even more, to the point where when I lost my dad a few years ago, I was dealing with that trauma. And it wasn't until I sat and penned a letter to him that I felt some type of healing and overcoming that trauma. Not fully healed from it yet, but it definitely pushed me closer to being in a place where I could accept it. So the pen and writing is super important. And I'm realizing more and more that you have to write like your life depends on it. Especially in this day and age where so much of our freedoms are being taken away. The one thing can't be censored fully yet is putting the pen to the paper and getting those thoughts and speaking your truth. So to Christine, you're right. If you don't fight, you absolutely can't win. So thank you. And I'm grateful, Mark, for your tutelage. You are utterly patient and you find a way to get the best out of the students. It's not like most, like I've been to one other like poetry workshop, and it's almost like when you're there, you're being told that you need to kind of mold yourself and fit yourself in a particular way so that you're between the lines and you're writing in and out of a particular form. And while we study different forms, Mark allows us to kind of get the free range and use our natural authentic voice, which has just been freeing for me. And over the course of the year, which, you know, it's been a challenging past year and a half. And I feel like challenging is an understatement, but nevertheless, it's been challenging. And, you know, putting the pen to the paper has been freeing, especially when there wasn't much else to really do.
Thank you, Alondo. That was incredibly generous. Maybe I'll circle back to this, but it does seem that trauma is the underlying sort of language of a lot of the work tonight. And I just want to honor that and recognize it. But I do have another question from Emily. And again, it's to anyone who wants to step up. So what was it about haiku that spoke to this moment for you?
Mark, you wanted to go? Okay. Could I say what spoke to us in this moment and me? Here you are, I'm organizing with immigrant women of color who are not deemed essential worker. Yet they are essential worker, going to work in the heights of COVID. And there was a haiku that I write. It just came to me. It says, Bangladeshi men deliver tacos. Bitter days, Upper East Side. Bangladeshi men deliver tacos. Bitter days, Upper East Side. Here it is, the immigrants on bicycles. That Bangladeshi could have been a Mexican, could be a Caribbean person, could have been anybody. But people are in the luxury of their homes in the heights of COVID, and they are delivering food. Well, women who have no business going to work, immigrant women of color, who is going to work. When I talk about grown women and those women who are sitting on the above the train track. Could somebody mute you? Somebody mute you? There's background noise. Thank you. Yes. Those women are going to work. Some of them were catching COVID-19. Their employers weren't telling them. And I look into the recesses of my heart and my mind. And I am standing up for these women. Fearfully and fearlessly so. And those poems came to me and it informed me in the heights of COVID, how do you tell these women stay home? What our organization did was to give these women, we got grants, to give these women little love offering, to tie them over with medicine, rents if need be, and food if need be, because there was no income coming in for those women who were going to work in the heights of COVID. Whose employer was saying to them, if you don't come, you're fired. And I started to write from that place. Those brown women who were wearing the Lady of Guadalupe amulet around their index finger, wanting to give their employers the middle finger. Hello. That's what informed my work, because I stand for those women. I am she. And I'm writing from that place of truth, not being able to say to my employers, don't they know what I do? But that informed why I did what I did, the haikus. And they were easy. They were tricky. Not that simplistic, but it challenged us to really come forth from a place of truth. Yes?
Yeah. They have a punch, too. The brevity, yes. Power, and punch.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. I don't have any more questions. I'm open to continuing to discuss. We have a few more minutes. We have 3 minutes. If anyone wants to say anything in closing.
Keely.
Oh, you got Keely.
I just want to thank everyone who read. It's wonderful to hear your work again. And I'm just honored to be among the participants and the listeners, because you could be doing something else. And so it's wonderful that Mark continued to network and use his platform to engage others to hear our stories. So I just want to thank you all for making the time to hear who we are and to understand that we exist, even though sometimes writing is not easy because we have been misled into thinking our stories don't count. But Mark make a point of, you know, being patient enough to say you're going to write before the class ends. And so this is the result of ongoing support and ongoing family support of low-income workers, immigrants, people that are not valued in our society as if they're not contributing. So thank you all for everything.
Thank you, Kevin.
And also, in terms of like the form, I must say, like, I was introduced to the haiku in high school, but never really practiced it. And when Mark introduced us to it at the Worker Writer School, I was hesitant to it because I also was just at 17 syllables. It's hard to express what I want to say. And at the time, you know, I felt like I had a whole lot that I wanted to talk about, but to get it down into 17 syllables felt like a challenge. However, over practicing it and continuously writing in the form, I find that it's becoming a bit more easier. And to the point where it's almost like in a world where, you know, where it's ever our words and, you know, if someone getting censored at times, I feel like I could be subversive in these 17 syllables in a way in which if I were to write, like, let's say a free verse or a longer form poem, it, like, those ideas would be out there. But like you could, as you said, Tanya, as you was alluding to, it definitely does pack a punch. And, you know, being someone who speaks Patois, finding ways to mix the Patois and the English in a very subversive fashion is fun and engaging for me. So I'm like on this like radicalization of the haiku trajectory, which is super dope and exciting to work with. But at first it was challenging. I'm not gonna hold you.
What can I say to Orlando? June Jordan, I've been writing for a long time, and I've written with writers, creme de la creme writers of the African-American entity, if you may. And June, I remember going to Nikki Giovanni's reading. It was on the Upper West Side. And June Jordan, before she passed on, said to me, because I struggled, as Seth was saying, or Davidson was saying in so many ways, to fit into this thing. You know, do I sound like this American writer? Do I sound like Richard Wright? Do I sound like Nikki Giovanni? And we're Caribbean folks. And June Jordan said to me before she died, and that stuck with me forever. Write from your voice. Write from, you talk about the pathway. You don't have to make excuse for that.
Yeah.
It will reveal itself. People will know where you come from. They'll see your soul through your writing. Don't ever make excuse for it. If you want to put a footnote, you could do that. But stay true to your voice. And that's what June Jordan said to me, you know, just before she passed on. And she too was an activist here of Caribbean descent. Her father was a Barbadian and she wrote about the soldier's daughter. But she said that to me in the moment when nobody else said that to me, because I was sitting in classes with American writers and struggling with my voice. Do I sound like this side of the room? Or do I? And then she said, being your authentic self, but speak from your voice. And ever since, I'm on the roof. Mm. Yeah.
I just wanted to say, we've had a lot of fun in this workshop. It's not all just the world is on top of us. We've had a lot of laughs. We've shared our stories with each other. We've read our work from ice cream parlors to the boardwalk in Coney Island and art galleries. And we've really bonded that way, going to these events together and gotten to know each other a lot, much more than we do just coming to a workshop once a month. So that's been a beautiful thing for me. And I think for a lot of the people in the workshop, we've really had a lot of fun together.
That's a perfect note to end on. Unfortunately, it's already after 6 and we said we'd turn this off at around 6 o'clock because I know it's late for you all. It's very late. So I'd love to thank you all again. This has just been an incredible evening, far surpassing anything I ever thought it could be. And I know Steve and I are both really grateful that you said that you would do this and taking a chance doing this online live. That's a big deal too. So thank you all. And thanks to our audience for showing up and honoring the voices of these writers.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Lauren. Thank you, Fondo. Thank you, Seth. Thank you, Mark Nowak. Thank you, Davidson.
Thank you. We got through it.
You did.
I didn't realize that was recommended in some cases.